Honorable Benduke Nivulaitana, thank you for speaking with the Villager today.
You're most welcome.
You've come out to contest for the position of the Vice President of the SWAPO Party. This is your constitutional right. What makes you think you can handle the position?
Well, I wish you had asked me this question in 2012. This is not the first time that I'm contesting for the position, but in 2012 I did. And that time I was breaking the ceiling, actually, for the women of this country to realize that there is nothing under the sun that they are not able to do, provided it's within their biological makeup. Otherwise, the party, SWAPO Party, has granted its members the opportunity to elect and get elected, irrespective of gender, race, or color. And that's why I felt, well, if I'm nominated to stand for the position, why not?
And what reforms do you think your position is going to bring to the party itself?
Well, the position of a vice president or a vice or deputy is always to assist the substantive head. In this respect, the vice president of the party is to assist the president in fulfilling his, this time I say his because all the candidates are men, otherwise I could have said his or her, but fortunate or unfortunate, this time all candidates are men, and therefore we expect one of the men to win the position, and therefore the vice president is going to assist in the formulation of policies, in expanding programs within the party, and assistance is not just in terms of what one is asked to assist with, but also to think, you know, and bring about a proposal that the president or the party can look at and say, this one, it's suitable and therefore acceptable, we can, we can implement it. So I see my role as such.
You're talking about breaking the glass ceiling for the women in Namibia there. And the fact that we are seeing a lot of men, all of the men actually contesting for the first position, that of the president of the SWAPO party. Don't you think that women are scared of getting to that level? We are seeing a lot of the ladies, starting with you, you're contesting the vice president. So why not the president?
Well, the standing for a position, it's a personal matter. People have to evaluate themselves whether they are ready for a position or not. It's not a matter of forcing someone to get into a contestation. However, all along, the party positions have been held by men exclusively until later. That, for example, I can, heap this accolade on myself to have stood for the position of Secretary General of the party and won, you know, by democratic means. That was the first time that a woman has stood for a higher position of that of a Secretary General and win. I won that position, and that has made history, actually, to such an extent that when the vice president position also opened, you know, I challenged it, you know, for the demonstration that women are coming. Women should no longer, you know, feel there are certain areas where they are restricted. We are growing with time. Just give us time. Maybe with those that are younger than myself are going to challenge the position of the president.
You did not make part of the first list of the list that was brought about by the acting president of the SWAPO party, the president of the nation himself, Honorable Hage Geingob. Why so?
Well, procedurally, it has never happened in the party. I was not even expecting it. Even if it was come my way, probably I could have advised differently. But be that it is, it came, and what I know is that the structures that have nominated me are the legitimate structures, and I feel proud that I was nominated by the legitimate structures of the party, and I'm very, very happy.
So in other words, are you saying that the decision by the president to nominate his four nominees was actually a breach of the constitution or the unwritten law of seniority within the SWAPO party?
I'm just saying I've never experienced it before. It happened for the first time. I'm not saying whether it is wrong or right, but I'm just saying I was not even expecting it because I never saw it happening that way.
There have been people that are saying that the SWAPO constitution has been trampled over and over, and these people want to correct this. Do you think that the constitution has been trampled?
Well, maybe this is not the platform where to talk about some of these matters. We can live with them for, you know, some other time. But today, let's talk about my, you know, nomination for the position of Vice President of the SWAPO Party.
Honorable, if you get nominated to be the Vice President of the SWAPO Party, that's an inch closer to getting to the position of having the possibility of you one day clinching the highest office of the land. Do you have presidential ambitions?
Currently, I'm vying to stand for the position of Vice President because I see my role, you know, as an assistant to the president to strengthen the position of the SWAPO party. My interest currently is to see that SWAPO party is strong, is operating in a manner that all its members are happy, and we continue to mobilize the populace of our country. We continue to educate the SWAPO party members in the understanding of the party they belong to, all without exception.
Can you maybe take us through some of the major achievements that you and your office have brought to SWAPO and to Namibia that you want to highlight to the people so that people can actually see a reflection of your possibility of being able to deliver once you're in office? What are some of the major highlight achievements that you've brought in your capacity?
Well, I don't know how young or how old you are and how informed you are about this person you are interviewing. This person has a long history within the party, and it's a person who can claim to have invested so much in the growth and strength of the party. I grew up in the party from the young age, secondary school student, leading other students in the youth league. I left the country, went into exile. I went through military training to strengthen the fighting arm of the SWAPO. I was a planned combatant, and when I served my duty as a planned combatant, I was given other responsibilities. For 11 years, I led the SWAPO women in exile as their secretary for the SWAPO party, the Women's Council, a position I held from 1980 to 1991. And I became one of the youngest members of the Central Committee ever since 1980 to date. I can only crown my work and contribution to SWAPO as its Secretary General, a position I held from 2007 to 2012, during a period of, you know, the critical challenges that befell the party when RDP was formed. If you were here, you would agree with me that were it not for that person, Comrade Pendukeni Ivulaitana, as Secretary General of the party at that particular time, probably today we will be talking about a weakened SWAPO party. Because when you have senior members of your party defecting, forming an opposition party, and you manage to keep the party together, there is that not credit. So when I'm standing for the position of vice president, and there are people behind me who are moving me on, are those with experience that woman is able to do, is able to deliver. And therefore, we are putting our head on the block for her to become our next vice president.
Do you think that the delegates are going to vote with their conscience? Are you not afraid that they might get remote control?
Well, society is made up of different types of people. Even in SWAPO party, we are different. During the liberation struggle here, there were those who were committed to the liberation of the country. And consciously, they left the country. Consciously, they stayed in the country and supported the liberation war. But there were those who felt, despite the oppression, despite whatever they were seeing, they rather, you know, side with the South African forces. So, people are just different. And therefore, for me to say everybody is going to vote consciously or not, I would be presumptuous, really.
So what message do you have to these delegates that are going to be voting? What message would you want to give them as far as voting and making the right decision is concerned?
No, to the SWAPO party members, I always say, we are lucky to belong to a matured party. A matured party that has all the guiding, all the founding documents in place that are guiding us as to the aims and objectives of our party. What is that we should look at when we are electing a leader? What is it? Is it a leader to give us position tomorrow? Is it a leader to embrace the well-being of the citizenry? Or what kind of a leader are we looking at? And that's what I want the voters, the delegates to the 6th Congress of the SWAPO Party to think. What future do they want for the country in the first place? Because SWAPO is not just one of the political parties. It's a ruling party. And when we rule the country as a party, we must share whatever there is with everybody. Everybody. Party members, non-party members, everybody equally. And therefore the aim is to arrive at that balance. But if we take our interest, personal interest, first before that of the country, that before that of the party, then we have it all wrong.
Honorable, you've been in the media recently, a few weeks ago, where you made some bold statements, and you say that what makes the acting president think that he's going to be elected anyway, suggesting that it is not obvious that he might get that position. There's a probability that he might not. Do you think the president deserves a second term in office?
Well, whether you are quoting me verbatim or maybe that's a construed understanding, I don't know. But what I believe is that when you have a contestation of more than one, you can't contest when you are just one. It must be two, three, and so on. When you have a contestation, there is no guarantee, including me. I participated in the 2012 Congress. I didn't know whether I was going to win or lose, but eventually I lost. But so what? I lost to a comrade. I lost to a comrade, and therefore no ill feelings for me. I'm just saying, in democracy, there is no guarantee that it is me to win, unless if I'm going to manipulate you something, then I can have a guarantee. But if it is just to place everything in the hands of the voters, we can campaign, we can lobby, we can do everything possible. Then we'll leave it up to them. Then only we will know after the facts whether we have made it or not. But I cannot be presumptuous. And I don't even think the president is also presumptuous. As long as we have allowed the democracy to prevail, three candidates for the position, then we leave everything in the hands of the voters.
You come a long way with SWAPO. You have been to the trenches. You have seen SWAPO from the beginning until now, many, many decades. Can you tell us, is the SWAPO of your time when you were in exile the same SWAPO that is there today? What has changed?
Well, it can never be the same again. Because when we were fighting for the liberation of the country, the spirit and the mode of doing it was completely different. And that's why when we came back at the first Congress in 1992, we changed the constitution, changed some few things within the constitution to make ourselves a party and no longer a movement. A party that is supposed to be focused on particular issues that are supposed to be guiding us. Before, we were just, let's fight to liberate our country. Now the country is liberated, we need to be focused as a party. And therefore, what used to appeal to everybody in exile was independence. Now that independence is here, different interests are developing. And that's why we feel we needed to change the constitution so that we give some guidelines as to how to belong to one political party.
And we have seen recently developments within SWAPO party of certain elements now moving out of the party and even thinking about coming up with their own political parties, for example, the Landless People's Movement. Is this a reflection of democracy within Namibia, or do you see this as a weakness on the part of SWAPO that certain people are disintegrating from the party to form other movements?
Well, I don't believe that movement is necessarily a political party until it moves really into becoming a political party. The land issue in our country is a serious matter. We are trying to contain the feelings, and we are trying to manage it, but it's not an easy thing, because in reality there are people who feel the pinch. There are people who are homeless, there are people who are living here, but they live in other people's property for forever. It's a real issue, a real challenge. And if somebody is talking about it, and we want to relegate that person as wanting to create a political party, then we are missing the point. We are missing the point. The party should listen with open ears to all those who are coming up with a different approach to different issues, and give them audience, give them platform where to listen to one another and find a solution.
I'm going to ask you a very blunt question, Honorable. Do you think you're going to win this time?
I have said, in contestation, in a democratic exercise, one cannot be presumptuous. I don't want to be presumptuous, but I know my strength. I do. I'm an experienced politician. I'm known for delivery. This ministry is an example. When I came here, nobody wanted to be appointed as Minister of Home Affairs and Immigration. That's the truth of the matter. When I came here, I did what I did, and I turned around this ministry. When I went to the party as Secretary General, a member saw wide and huge difference. And I don't want to claim glory, but I'm saying for people to see the importance of the office of the Secretary General started in my era. It's when people started realizing that, oh, apparently this position is important. Yeah, the position can only be important as long as the person occupying it is making it lively, gives it life. I'm able to deliver. That's my record. And if people want progress, if our members want progress, they want to see SWAPO growing, they rather just vote for Mimi Itala as their vice president. That will make us again to be who we are as SWAPO party members.
Cool.
Yes, when I served in the People's Liberation Army of Namibia, I was not just an ordinary soldier. Yeah. I started with a platoon commander, a platoon that was well known by my contemporary in plan as Okakua, because seven looks like an X. Okakua is a meaning in Oshawana. And then when we were sent abroad for further military training, I was made the deputy detachment commander of the troops, a position I held until I was just relieved to go for further education. And everywhere I went, really, I left trace of success. My 8 years as the Attorney General of this country, I can guarantee you, I can tell you, we have never lost a major case against the government. Never. It's not because I used to stand in the dock in court, but guiding the lawyers from behind the scene, it's what made us to be successful. And how to coordinate the legal team that was under my leadership was very, very crucial. So, at the party, although I have not gone into the details of what I did, as a female Secretary General, I felt that we were not making headways with some resolutions. There was a resolution on gender, equal gender representation, taken in 2002, the Congress of 2002. And that resolution was never implemented. And as Secretary General, I felt it was opportune, you know, for me now to make that resolution become a reality. So I sent a team to go and research with countries that have introduced gender quota. Mozambique, Tanzania, particularly. And they came back with the report on the basis of which we took a decision now that gender representation, 50-50 gender representation must be implemented. And that was on account that I managed to set up a team that was not part of the administration of the party headquarters, but I identified cadres within government who had the knowledge. And this team was led by the late Dr. Abraham Yam, may his soul rest in peace. He was the chairperson, and this team helped the party to research on various issues. And the Congress that we held in 2012 was packed with documents, because we before the Congress, we held a policy conference for the first time. I am the one who introduced it. For the first time, and we had the documents to guide the discussions. And we had a very successful Congress, packed with issues, well researched, and those resolutions were taken on the basis of knowledge, not just because we wanted to resolve a certain issues anyhow. And the position, you know, when I served as Secretary General, I was also Minister of Justice at the same time. And I realized how difficult it was to serve the party and government at the same time. And I once again entrusted this responsibility to the think tank to research it and advise the party how to deal with the Secretary General. That's why you see that Comrade Bumba, who is my successor, is on a full-time basis employed by the party. He is not a minister somewhere and a Secretary General. These are issues that I was able to bring within the party under my leadership. And therefore, really, given the opportunity to invest again, my skill, my ability, my knowledge within the party will be just a plus for the party.
Honorable, we understand that you were part of the Constituent Assembly. Can you take us through the time when we were coming up with our own constitution in Namibia? Mm. What role did you play?
Yeah, as I told you that I served as secretary for SWAPO Women's Council for a long time of 11 years, from 1980 to 1991. And the Constituent Assembly was formed after the elections, of the independence election in 1989. So I was part of the leadership of the party that participated now in the organization, because before the elections, I served as deputy secretary for legal affairs of the party, deputizing Dr. Ngarikutu Kesiriange. And from there now, we won the elections of 89 and formed the Constituent Assembly. The Constituent Assembly was a body, a legislative body, to come up with the constitution. But then all of us 72 members drawn from all political parties could not draft a constitution. So 12 members were elected, 11 men and one woman, and that one woman was myself, to draft the constitution. And that one woman was taken on account of her knowledge of women issues and broader knowledge also of the international community feelings on women issues. So I participated in that exercise, and we came up with this constitution that you know now. It does not just talk about him. We are talking about him or her, his or hers. Yeah, that kind of a language. It's a gender balance kind of a language. It's on account of my participation representing the Namibian women. I was not just representing myself. Then, of course, I also realized that as I told you, I have invested a lot in the party. When I left this country, I was a student, but I could not further my studies. And when independence came, I saw the opportunity to do what I wanted to do as a youngster. Despite my age, despite my ministerial responsibility, I enrolled at the University of Namibia and studied for my LLB degree. I'm a lawyer by training, and that has also helped me in dealing with challenges of the new independence era. That's why I was appointed as the first and so far the only female Attorney General who have served this country so far. And when I came to this ministry in order to turn it around, I felt there was also a need for me to brush my knowledge a little bit, to sharpen it. And that's how I enrolled with the University of International Management, IUM, for an MBA in management. So I just graduated last month with an MBA, just for the sake of knowledge, not accumulation of degrees, but to know what I can do, what needs to be done in the world of technology. The more you know, the better. So I'm not just one of the leaders, but it's also one of the leaders who has it.